will clean up all your talking in a manner such as this.
They will make you take a tinkle when you want to take a...
This is Musical Talk, the UK's independent musical theater podcast.
Ladies and gentlemen, hello, welcome to this week's episode. We're going to be discussing TV musicals, a sort of interesting media blend. But first, we're going to have an interview with a very respected TV comedian, Sanjeev Bhaskar, who was in a British TV show called Goodness Gracious Me. I'm also joined here by Thos Ribbits. Hello, Thos.
Hello. I wasn't actually on any television programme like that, with the possible exception of Crime Watch, perhaps. Whilst he's a sitcom star, he has something that's a bit more close to home in our world of musical theatre loving.
Yes, he's playing King Arthur in Spamalot, which is a wonderfully funny show. And I think coming from a comedy writer, it was interesting to hear his views on that. And after the interview, you're going to hear a chat with Lisa about various TV show musicals. And then it'll be back to me and Thos. So here is the interview with Sanjeev Bhaskar. I'm delighted to announce I'm joined here by Mr. Sanjeev Bhaskar, OBE of University of Hertfordshire.
Thank you very much. I'm a mouthful only because I'm eating, but I'm sorry about that.
It's one of those things. How are you today?
Not bad. Hungry.
Yes?
Didn't get a chance to eat, so I'm sort of stuffing my face as we speak. Probably the only example of multitasking you'll get from me, but there you go.
And for those of us not here, what are you eating? Can you share?
I'm eating a Swedish meatball ragu wrap. From Presimonje.
Sanjeev Bhaskar plays King Arthur in Spamalot, the Monty Python musical lovingly ripped off from the film Knights of the Holy Grail, in case you haven't heard of it.
Monty Python and the Holy Grail, just to be really geeky about it.
Right, take two. Monty Python and the Holy Grail. I presume you're enjoying this, because you'd have to be lying in a coffin, really, not to enjoy doing anything to do with this show.
I'm loving it, yeah. I mean, I was only originally meant to do it for 3 months, or my contract was 3 months. And when that was up, and they announced that Spamalot was closing in the West End in January, and asked me to stay, it was just one of the easiest decisions I think I've ever made in my life.
Now, you come from a background, as far as I'm concerned, of TV comedy.
Yeah.
Are you a fan of Monty Python and the Flying Circus and all the films?
Yeah, very much so. I mean, it's very difficult to be a particularly comedy writer and not be influenced by Monty Python. So the series, I was too young for it when it first came out. But so I caught the films first, actually, and I probably caught Holy Grail first. So, yeah, it's a film that I knew very well. And I mean, Monty Python is incredibly quotable. They played around with structure, which was very interesting. Which, I mean, Goodness Gracious Me was quite a traditional sketch show in that you had a setup and then you had a punchline. But the Pythons kind of dispensed with all of that, and so they would sort of comment on the sketch they'd just done. They would kind of not have a punchline. They would have go on a weird tangent and just use it as a transition. And that freed up the form. You know, traditionally comedy was about hitting a punchline, and suddenly Python came along and it was about a funny word, or it could be a funny sound, or it was really the sky's the limit. And I think that in that sense, knowing that the breadth that you have to work with, the kind of canvas that you have is so broad, was incredibly influential, I think, to most comedy writers.
A joke I've noticed a lot in Spamalot is one picked up by Family Guy, where they'll have a joke and they'll hit and hit and hit and hit and hit and until it just, it's funny, then it's not funny, then it's funny again.
Yeah.
Do you think you changed comedy, or the face of British comedy in Britain?
If we did anything at all, we perhaps showed that there was a greater myriad of voices that could come from Britain in terms of comedy. You know, comedy hadn't come from a British-Asian background before. So I suppose that we suggested that minorities in Britain could have a voice and have a comic voice that would cross over and be understood by the mainstream. As to changing it, I don't think I changed it. No, I changed anything,
because
including my pants.
Yes, I can tell.
Yeah, good. That's the Swedish.
Your Swedish, your Swedish rap in it.
Yes,
I know the two Ronnies dabbled in kind of Asian characters within their comedy.
They did, in
the Indian restaurant or something. I seem to remember.
Yeah, and I think that they were kind of embarrassed by it as years went by. I mean, I don't think they should have been, because it was a perfectly okay sketch.
They shouldn't be embarrassed by anything they did. They,
no, I think, yeah, and they were, but also they did everything with great affection. So, you know, as a viewer of something like that, I wasn't particularly offended by it at all. In the same way, Rowan Atkinson did an Indian waiter sketch. I mean, it wasn't kind of ethnically accurate, but it was funny. And so I don't mind that. I don't mind that at all. I mean, you know, when you get to doing comedy on the radio, for instance, you can...
If
you
Which can is where Goodness Gracious Me started.
Yeah, and we played all the characters. You know, we played, you know, Indian characters, British characters, white characters, you know, anything that was going. So as long as you can do it convincingly and do it with affection, I've got no objection.
Tell us about your wonderful brief encounter sketch.
The sketch.
Which...
Yeah,
fans of musical theatre, if they've seen the show in London, your sort of different twist on it.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I love films and I kind of love film parody. So I'm not quite sure where the idea popped into my head, but I just thought it would be very, very funny to have brief encounter, a farewell, a romantic farewell scene at a train station, put on an Indian railway station, which is kind of crowded and there's chickens and ducks and goats and...
And RP speaking English people.
Yeah, well, we had a couple of central characters were almost transported from 1940s Britain to a bustling train station in India. It was great fun to do. It was very filmic, the way it was shot and everything, but it was great fun to write. And I remember the only difficult thing about it was that we shot it at 3 o'clock in the morning. So... nerves, tempers, we're all getting a little frayed by the end of it. But it was great fun to do. One of the sketches I'm proudest of.
Now, I'm looking around here, I see Beatles songbooks, see a guitar, I see a fake book. Are you a big musical theatre fan?
Do you know, I haven't been, actually. I mean, I've been to see a few musicals, not that many. I've probably seen maybe three, four ever. Although I am a fan of musicals on film. But no, I just never got to the theatre to do it. But now I put these books about just to impress people.
It's worked.
No, good.
Have you written any tunes? Are you a composer or a songwriter yourself?
Well, I wrote a lot of the comedy songs, for Goodness Gracious Me.
Right.
And composed the music and played a lot of the music, actually, on
so
those.
So PRS is happy.
Yes, yeah, exactly. For Mumbai Calling, which is a sitcom that we shot in India, for the pilot, I composed the music for that. But not for the series. And actually for the Kumars, I composed a piece of music for that, but one of the producers rather sneakily gave it to someone else who did a sound alike, so I didn't get any credit for that at all. But
composers are clever, aren't they?
Yeah, do you know, I learned my lesson. But I am a fan of musical theatre now, I suppose.
Well, I suppose you need to be. I mean, do you think it helps to have... Because Spamalot makes fun of so many musicals and so many musical styles.
Yeah.
Were you aware of that in rehearsals? You know, the sort of reference to, I think, Company, when he sings Another 100 People Just Can Go to the Play and all that.
I didn't get all of them. I mean, I came to see the show and I got a lot of the obvious ones.
Like the Lloyd Webber joke and...
Yeah, the Lloyd Webber joke, and there's a kind of joke. It was a very Broadway-based joke as well. And in terms of a lot of the singing styles, there's a diva song called The Diva's Lament, for instance. A little bit of West Side Story is thrown in randomly at one point. So the broader ones I got, I think there's a reference to... Is it Funny Face? I think there might be as well.
You're picking up on ones I didn't even get. So.
Well, I may be wrong about that, because obviously it's... I don't
know. I'm sure it's changed over the... You know, because Eric's developed the show so much, and I hear he's actually coming next Wednesday.
I believe he's coming next week, yes, which is kind of very exciting. This is just me unwrapping. This is the sound. Unwrapping.
He's unwrapping his swede at the moment.
I'm unwrapping a wrap. There you go. Got this, like, you know, past the parcel. Except that I know what's at the bottom. There you go.
Is it nice?
It's delicious, yeah. I'm thoroughly enjoying it.
Now, there's a moment in the show which, I'll be honest, I don't think it has translated very well in this country. Do you know the bit I'm talking about?
Yes, I do.
The Jewish song and scene where you won't succeed in showbiz if you don't have any Jews.
Hmm.
Do you think that works here, or do you think it doesn't work here, or do you think the joke is big enough for people to get?
I do think the joke's big enough, yeah. I mean, I think it's a very, very Broadway reference, and it's not one that translates to the West End quite as clearly. But I think the song number itself...
It's the best song in the show, I think. It's a production number.
Yeah, and I mean, I'm sitting on stage watching it, and I'm not tired of it. I still love watching it. So I think, yeah, I think although you know that the gag doesn't work as well, the journey of the song itself, I think, is terrific, and I think it does work very well. And it's always very well received.
Yeah. Just watching the cast, and they do that dance know, the dance when they're sort of sliding on the floor and getting up again, and it's a brilliant, brilliant production all round. Mm. Did you hear that on Broadway it was just, you know, people queued for months, well not months, but hours and hours and hours to get...
They did, yeah. I mean, it made its money back in 6 months on Broadway, and I think it had, perhaps to date, I'm not sure about that, but it certainly had the biggest advance sales of any show on Broadway. And that's remarkable, especially considering that Python was not conceived as an international show. I mean, people are much more aware of that kind of thing now. But at the time, it was a show for the British public, in the same way that, you know, goodness gracious me and the Kumars, we never conceived that they would travel, but they did in the end. But
Well, probably like Little Britain as well. That was probably just meant to be a thing in Britain, but now we have Little Britain USA, and it's gone to Australia and all over the world.
Yeah, it's been shown everywhere. And I think that, you know, comedy travels well, actually. Comedy and sort of cop dramas seem to kind of travel well. So actually, maybe someone should combine the two. Kill someone and have a gag at the end of it.
I still want to do a pantomime murder mystery. I think that would be...
Well, go for it. My goodness, what an excellent idea.
Quite an interesting two genres to blend.
Although, 39 Steps. That sure. kind of does that. But not in a panto setting. So, you're still ahead.
Who would be
of
the dame, though? A man as a woman as a man as a woman.
Anthony Hopkins.
Yes. What's your favourite number in the show?
It's probably you won't succeed in showbiz if you don't have any Jews number, actually. I think that's probably my favourite. I mean, I don't get tired of singing Always Look on the Bright Side of Life, because it's just... It's such an embedded sense memory for me.
This is the only show I've seen where the audience sing along unprompted.
Yeah, it has been. Yeah, it's quite extraordinary, actually. You know, people start clapping and then singing along as well, and that's fantastic.
I mean, I remember once when I saw the show the first time with Tim Curry.
Mm.
People behind me, when the song came on, they said, "Come on, sing!"
Could someone on the third floor please close the lift gates? Could someone on the third floor please close the lift gates? Thank you.
That's God. That was God talking.
That's John Cleese.
Yes.
That joke always goes down very well.
Yeah, the recognition thing of John Cleese's voice in the show is kind of it's such a lovely addition.
The Pythons themselves weren't too keen on Spamalot.
Well, they all turned up to the premiere. And I believe they've seen it a few times since. I mean, Terry Jones came to see it, and he was very complimentary about it. Mm-hmm. And he was very complimentary about this production. And in fact, in front of me, he recommended it to Michael Palin. Yeah, I think that...
they've warmed to it, do you think?
I think perhaps they've warmed to it, yeah. And also, I think each king plays it slightly differently. So I think that depending on what production you go and see, you know, I might go and see a play two or three times. If I go and see Hamlet or something, you can see a Hamlet that particularly speaks to you. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, you know, it speaks to the person next to you. But certainly, to me, Terry Jones and Michael Palin were both very glowing.
You've been accepted by gods, then?
You know, as a Python fan, it doesn't really get much better than that.
Did you work with Mike Nichols?
No, I didn't. I've not met him. No.
Because he's meant to be a wonderfully funny guy. And what I love about what he did for the show is he uses every style of comedy available, you know, from vaudeville and music hall and the brash comedy, you know, very physical comedy, you know, that bit when they travel around the world and they have the two guys in the
diorama.
Yeah, the diorama, thank you.
Yeah.
I don't wish to offend you, but King Arthur is not the main part. It's a big ensemble piece.
Oh, absolutely, yeah, gosh. I mean, it doesn't offend me at all. I mean, it's absolutely an ensemble piece. You know, I try to fit the... King Arthur shaped hole in the jigsaw that I have to fill, but I've got used to it now. There's nothing that lubricants can't fix, it's absolutely an ensemble piece. And I think that King Arthur, if anything, is an anchor point.
He's the catalyst for the whole.
Yeah, and you know, he's a consistent character. You come back to you share his journey,
and you're certainly the reason a lot of the British public come to see this show.
Well, that's very kind of you. Can't be true.
Well, I think it is true, and it's my show, so... But I think when they sit down and they see it, they're amazed by everyone, because it's such a... I mean, it's a short show, but probably because it's so hard work for everyone involved.
Yeah, and well, it's also that... the adage about comedy, you know, it's only as funny as long as it's funny, and You know, one of the things about Mike Nichols is that, which generally people may not know, is that he started out in comedy, and was part of a very successful double act in the 50s and 60s before he started directing. So he was kind of...
He knows where he's coming from.
Yeah, I mean, he's experienced it. He's experienced it as a writer and a performer before making his name as a director with Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf and The Graduate and everything on from there. So, yeah, it's very much an ensemble thing. And it's because I think that you've got people like Mike Nichols and Eric Idle, people who've kind of...
Know comedy
well. Yeah, it means the construct is it's going to be useful. So, yeah, I think that rather than adapting it from someone else's work.
So what do you bring to the role that, as a comedy actor? I mean, apart from the fact you're acting comedy. Or do you take it seriously and think about the character and just sort of...
Yeah, I do. I mean, I think that you are playing a character, and what you want to suggest with a character is that there is there are several sides. Otherwise you have a caricature. And that's kind of fine for comedy. Comedies have thrived on caricatures. But for me, yeah, it's trying to find another level to it and not make him two-dimensional. And I think that... I mean, I'm sure the other actors who played the King did that as well. But each person has their own approach to it. I mean, Tim Curry's a very seasoned comedy actor. I mean, he's done plenty of them. And so he knows what he's doing. Mm-hmm. As does Simon Russell Beale, who can do everything. Peter Davison has done enough comedy to know what he's doing. And Alan Dale is an Ugly Betty and...
Neighbours.
Neighbours, the hilarious sitcom on Down Under. So I think that, you know, it's... If there's anything that I bring, I suppose it's... Less as an actor, actually, more as a writer, and somebody who's directed comedy. I guess I'm looking for the balance within a scene, which you do as... That may be the difference between me and the others, is not so much the acting background, but the writing background. I don't think the others are writers. So, certainly as a writer... I think you look at a scene as a whole. When you're writing a scene, you're not writing a gag. You're writing a structure, you're writing a fully rounded piece, of a journey of some kind. And so when I look at a show like that, like Spamalot, then as a performer, I bring that sensibility in, I think. Where you look at the whole thing, you look at where your character fits in as a whole, rather than just what your lines are, or you know how funny you can make your lines. It's about whether that fits in with what's happening around you, and that I think comes from the writing and the directing side.
What do you say to the... Why did you drop your food everywhere?
I have. It's a disaster.
There's a bit where you said it's a symbol. That is a sound of a symbol, and you say something in some Indian language to...
Indeed, Punjabi.
Yes. What are you saying?
I'm saying death to the white man.
Okay.
For all that he's done to us. No, it's what I'm saying in Punjabi.
Oh, you weren't saying...
No, I wasn't. No, it wouldn't be so brusque. No, it's what I'm saying at that point to the conductor is, if you do that again, which I say in English, followed by you'd be given a slap, taken outside, your passport will be taken, you'd be deported.
Say that in Punjabi?
And do you think
there are people in the audience who get that?
The Punjabis do, but to help them, there is the...
The subtitles.
Well, there's the words in English, the passport and deportation, I think, are the key phrases in that particular sentence.
Was that something you did from the beginning?
No, it isn't, actually. No, that crept in and got a good response, so I kind of kept that in, and then I ad-lib after that as well. The ad-lib I do after that, it just comes to me.
What is the rule on ad-libbing in this show?
It's probably don't, as right. Most people who've kind of taken the time and effort to write a script will...
It's the same with composers and improvising, probably.
Yeah, it is. I mean, there were areas that I found that I could improvise, and...
Like when the audience member comes onto the stage.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there is a script there, but I go off the script a bit. I feel you can do that if... As long as you're not treading on, you know, the script itself, if you're not taking it too far from that. So I try to keep them limited, and I try to keep them sparse. Mm-hmm. But also, that again, it's something I do. I've always improvised, and improvised in character and stuff. So hopefully within the tone of the show, it kind of works. No one's told me to stop.
I mean, it's in the best way. This is the stupidest show I've ever seen, and it's just a complete joy from beginning to end. From the minute the orchestra has sounds of sheep,
yes,
you just know what kind of a show you're in for.
It is. It's a very, very silly show, and I think it celebrates silliness, and I think that's the real joy of it.
Early on in the show's run, there was a curtain that which would come down after the show, which said "piss off" on it.
Oh, right.
To the audience, and people complained about that.
Did they really?
And they had to remove it. And I thought it was one of the funniest things I've ever. But and people make the mistake of bringing kids to this show, though.
I do know. I don't think that is a mistake.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it is. I mean, there's a couple of risque jokes in it, but it is something that I've seen entire families enjoy. I mean, the kids enjoy the spectacle of it. They enjoy the rabbit. They enjoy the Knights of Knee and the very visual stuff.
The
adults' numbers are kind of big, so they kind of like that. And, you know, the more subtle and risque stuff they probably wouldn't get anyway. So no, I don't think it's a mistake to bring the kids to.
I've seen some of the cut songs from this show, and in the big dance number, Spamalot, there's some rhymes which they never made it into the show. You know, everything to rhyme with Spamalot. Our actors here ham a lot, we do am dram a lot.
Yeah, right.
We dine on crab and clam a lot. Now, I wish they kept that in. There are rumours apparently of a musical of The Life of Brian.
This is only from what I've read on the internet, but...
Which begs the question, will it have Always Look on the Bright Side of Life in it?
I think almost undoubtedly. No, I think there was a kind of operetta that was done called He's Not the Messiah, He's a
Very Naughty, very naughty
boy, which has been performed in America, but not done as a musical. I think it was done as a kind of an operetta or an orchestral piece, really, orchestral piece with stuff added to it. Few people singing stuff, but I haven't heard anything more than.
You're gonna try and see some musicals now. Your eyes have been.
Well, I have. I went to see Jersey Boys, which, over the road, which I really enjoyed. Yeah, I think it's fantastic.
We've had Ryan Malloy on, who.
Oh, he was brilliant.
Plays Frankie Valli.
Absolutely,
such
vocally
a phenomenal,
stunning. I mean, just effortless.
Is that a part you can see yourself?
I can't get that high. Are you joking? It's
tight trousers does the trick, I think.
Tight trousers. I'm wearing them now. Look where my voice is. No, and Dennis Lawson, who I've worked with, is in Le Cage aux Folles. So I'll probably pop along to see that.
It's always hard being in a show because you never can really find time to go and see other shows.
It's tricky. Yeah, I mean, so I'm looking at the matinees really. But I don't do Monday night, so it was a Monday night I went to see Jersey Boys. But, I'm looking forward to seeing more, actually.
Is it still an enthusiastic audience for Jersey Boys?
It was at the end. It wasn't during the show when I went to see it, but that's, I think they were just very old.
They're British, were they?
They were very British and very old. So the combination of the two means they were quiet during the show, but rapturous at the end.
What do you think makes up of a British audience?
I think that they do tend to be more reserved. Yeah, I think that there's a politeness factor, which is a hangover, and also I think America being a newer country and a lot of the forms of entertainment being newer is seen as far more participatory than it is here.
Never thought of it that way.
So yeah, where if you look at things like, you know, Jerry Springer Show and all those kind of things, people are very ready to participate. They want to whoop, they want to shout, they want to scream, they want to laugh, they want to applaud. You know, America's one of those places where you kind of say, Liberace would say, do you like my suit? And people would applaud.
We're going to let you go, Sanjeev. Thank you very, very much for your...
Thank you. I'm going to get changed to do my warm-up.
Into your chain armour.
Yes.
You're listening to Musical Talk.
Oh, that was very interesting, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Now I'm going to hand you over to Lisa, who's going to discuss a TV show called Britannia High and various other TV musicals. And when we come back, we shall discuss Britannia High and other various TV musicals.
Musical Talk.
We're going to be discussing Britannia High.
Yep, it's ITV's answer to High School Musical.
And Fame.
Yeah.
And The Biz, if you remember that show from when we were young.
I loved The Biz.
Yeah.
Just, for the record, I absolutely loved The Biz and can still sing part of the theme tune, but I won't torture you all with that.
Oh, go on, I got the echo on.
Nope, not a chance.
Oh, come on.
Nope.
Here's your note.
Forget it.
Okay, all right, sorry. What were the lyrics of the theme tune?
It for the Biz?
Yeah.
It goes something like, we all want it bad enough and there's nothing we won't do. Something to that effect. So, what were the lyrics? I love the Biz. I never, ever missed it. Actually, can we bring back the Biz instead of having Britannia High?
Now, what do you think of Britannia High?
Do you know, from a production point of view, actually, it's very well put together.
Yeah.
And it knows its target market. It really does. I can tell I'm definitely not in that target market.
And you think High School Musical audience is the target market?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah.
It's definitely sort of Britain's answer. Although, to be fair, it's slightly older.
Yeah, because it's sort of college, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It's college. Although some of my friends have argued that, you know, you don't have places called high school.
It's a trend starting to appear in this country, but you certainly wouldn't have a school called Britannia High.
I like the idea of Britannia High. I think it's 30 minutes too long an episode, and it has predictable plot lines. But Gary Barlow is the lead songwriter on it, and he's very good.
Right.
I think Gary Barlow's a great songwriter.
I didn't know that. When it first aired on Sunday night, it lost out, as far as ratings go, to the Antiques Roadshow.
To be fair, though, the first episode was available online about 3 days before it was shown on ITV. So if you watched it online, why would you watch it on ITV on air day?
Now,
there's no point.
Was I watching the first episode? Because the only bit I remember is when they broke out into the Family Guy theme song, which we'll talk about later.
I think that was the second episode.
Okay, so give us a clue of the characters and the stories that you saw in the first episode.
Well, Britannia High, I mean, basically, you've got your usual characters when it comes to these things. You've got the posh girl. Her name's Claudine. She's the one with the sort of the dark short hair.
Yeah.
She's kind of sort of the popular girl.
Right.
And her sort of the character you're supposed to feel sorry for is Lauren. And Lauren's the one who the head teacher has decided to sort of take a chance on. Everyone else has had to work really hard to audition for their places at Britannia High. But the head teacher has taken a gamble with Lauren and sort of let her in without an audition.
Right.
And Claudine, who's sort of the popular snotty character, found out about this sort of episode one and basically uses it against Lauren, who's then given the role of sort of underdog fighting to prove that she's there. And that's really what episode one focused on, was Lauren's sort of struggle for survival, in where she's only kind of got her talent, works for it. It's this raw talent. And it basically culminates with, shockingly, her actually proving that she can do it. So, gripping stuff.
What I did find laughable in the second episode, which I obviously saw, were the scenarios in which the songs came out of and how over the top it was. Very much like High School Musical and Grease in a way, I think.
That is basically what they're going for. I mean, it's Arlene Phillips is one of the people behind it.
Okay.
And she's kind of, it is Britain's answer to High School Musical, and therefore you've got to have the same sort of formulaic stuff that has made High School Musical just as popular as it is. Let's be honest, the High School Musical market is fairly well saturated with the High School Musical franchises. There's three of the films out and more merchandise than you could ever want that has HSM on it. How successful this will be, I'm not sure. As you pointed out, the ratings aren't fantastic. I mean, it is a good idea, and the people who are backing it are very good and very well respected. But I'm just not convinced there's actually a gap in the market for it.
I sound so old saying this, but we are. Remember when we were growing up, you had things on ITV like the Children's Ward. Do you remember that?
Yep, I remember Children's Ward.
And you had the sort of, you had Biker Grove and all the kind of gritty teen dramas. Sadly, the children's section of ITV doesn't exist anymore. When we got home from school, we had CITV and we had CBBC. They were the two rivaling shows. Do you think if they still had that slot, Britannia High would fit perfectly, you know, in place of the kind of teen drama?
I think it would. I don't think it's Sunday night television.
No.
I really don't. I think what it strictly is filling that kind of family TV slot at the moment. And later on in the year we'll have, it'll soon be I'm a Celebrity time, and then before you know it, it's Dancing on Ice again, and so on and so forth. There are more family shows. There's no way my dad would watch it. He wouldn't have watched it when I was a kid either. It's not his thing. Perhaps I'm old fashioned in that Sunday to me is a family day. That's when I see my family.
Yeah.
And, you know, my grands watch Strictly, and, you know, it's that's something that everyone can sort of
the generation game.
Get involved. Yeah, the generation game. It's that kind of, you know, everyone can have a say in it and get involved with it, whereas Britannia High, it's very teen-orientated. The issues are teen-orientated. And I think, you know, if with so much of the content available online, I think they definitely hurt themselves by making that first episode available before they showed it. I think they shot themselves in the foot. And with TV on demand, with most of the channels now, most of the channels do actually stream after the event online. So you don't have to sit down on Sunday night and watch it religiously. So whether the viewing figures are actually accurate for the number of people that are actually watching it overall, I'm not sure. But people I know who have watched it, and I'll be honest, all of them were watching it for Adam Garcia and Adam Garcia only. Yeah, he's not really in it much, but that's why they're watching it for him. Pardon?
That's why they were watching it for him, to see when he appeared.
Pretty much, yeah. Not going to lie, that's shallow. That's it in black and white. He wasn't in episode two, and the discussions I've had, nobody wants to watch the third episode because the first two were just so diabolical.
Yes.
You're just like, well, there's 2 hours of my life I won't get back.
Now, what's wrong with this show, do you think, apart from the title?
I'm still not sure whether it is just the fact that I'm completely the wrong demographic. I'm not sure whether there is quite a strong element of that. I do like musicals, and I do think the songs are very well written and have fantastic lyrics and meaning behind them. But I never had that aspirational inner stage school type thing. So it's not something where I'm like, oh, I wish I could do that, or I wish I could be that, because I know I'm not that talented. And it's just, you know, it's never been something that's been remotely on my agenda. And also, because I'm that little bit older, I don't fit in with any of these characters now. There's not one that I would fit with. I probably am more the age range of the teachers. So I mentioned it to my one of my cousins, who is 16, and she hadn't heard of it. She had no idea what I was talking about.
Okay.
It was trailered to death on ITV1. They did a massive digital marketing campaign. I mean, it was huge with their coming soon. So there has been a huge marketing campaign behind it.
Listen to you with your technical terms.
Yeah, it's my job, unfortunately. That I do know about.
Yeah. The problem I have with it was that, like with a lot of these shows, is it glamorizes these kind of schools. I have a friend who goes to Arts Ed, which is you know, one of the big drama schools in the country. It's just down the road from the studios. And she said, and I quote, in her Facebook status, "I don't care what people say, Britannia High is a pile of shit." And purely because it glamorizes, you know, it makes it look everything's a breeze and it's all, everyone's beautiful and everyone, you know, passes their classes and things.
Last week's episode content did actually focus on somebody who was struggling and, you know, didn't have an interest in the theory and some of the aspects of the work, and wasn't coping with the workload as a result.
He still has talent and he will still make it, I guess.
Quite probably, but I think most of the TV shows that we watch glamorize some aspect of life, or you wouldn't watch them. You know, why I'm not a huge soap fan. I don't watch the likes of EastEnders and Coronation Street and things like that, because, you know, I think I've got enough drama to deal with in my life very much, so I'm not going to watch that. But the programmes that I do watch, it is a little bit about escapism. I'm not going to sit and watch a programme. And you can't also have a programme where, you know, these kids are supposed to be bursting into song in a few minutes if it's all truly miserable. And if you don't glamorise these things, would anyone ever want to go to stage school ever? If people knew truly what a hard slog it was going to be, I don't think as many people would put themselves up for it, for starters, because once anyone sees, you know, scratches behind the surface of something and sees what really lies beneath, the instinct is to go, well, actually, wait a minute, where's the easy route? And there is no easy route with stage school, and you'd be absolutely daft if you think there is, because talent, yeah, it's great if you've got talent and it's a fantastic starting block, but it is a starting block. It's, you know, it's never going to be a breeze. And I'm sure anyone who's at a stage school or arts ed or wherever at the moment would agree with me. There's a lot of hard work that goes into getting there. Getting a break is fantastic, but you have to work to get it.
And do you think this show proves that?
It depends what you mean by that. I think the show does, certainly the first episode showed for me the character Lauren is juggling her life attending college with having to work at a restaurant as a kitchen porter, and she's in back alleys trying to learn dance routines that she doesn't understand because she's never really had to dance before. And I think that actually did show what a reality it is for some people, because I'm sure there are some people right now who are in their first year going, oh my God, what have I got into?
Yeah.
And they're juggling a job that's rubbish and the pay's rubbish and they're getting up early and they're maybe falling asleep in their classes. So it's not all sequins and, oh, look how fabulous the show went. There is an edge of, I think they've got the balance right. There is more grit and reality in it than High School Musical has, that's for sure.
Do you think the songs within the show, A, do you think they move the plot forward? And B, do you think they're more dream sequences than actual songs happening in real time?
I think they're more almost sort of dream sequences or set pieces. It's kind of removed from the plot. So just from my viewing, I was just like, well, that kind of... But musicals are always a bit like that. Oh, let's have a song here.
Yeah, bad musicals are like that.
Bad musicals are like that, which is my next point. There are musicals where you just go, oh, I need to put a song there because you didn't know quite what else to do, but it didn't advance the plot.
In shows like Chicago and things like that, it's more commenting on the action.
At risk of being crucified, there's definitely an element of, well, let's put the ballady song in here and... You know, and at least, and certainly, definitely in the first episode, there was one or two moments where you're like, oh, the song's coming now and it's going to be about how hard things are, or she's going to prove herself right now. So there's an element of predictability from someone who's seen a lot of musicals and stuff. I could see, oh, right, okay, here it comes. Or they're going to do something here.
It almost seems as if High School Musical has invented a genre.
I was wondering if it has, but at the same point, I'm not sure how it's going to translate out with the school environment, because obviously Britannia High, it's not school, but it's still within that structured environment, and it's how it would translate to anything else. And there's only so much you can do that's set within the parameters of a high school or a further education institute before everyone goes, okay, you've covered every aspect of teenage angst that you can and put it to music, enough already.
Yeah, thank you, Rent.
But I think Disney certainly have coined something with this, because Camp Rock was out this year and that's huge and it fits into a similar genre as, you know, High School Musical. And Camp Rock, when I was over in New York, Jonas Brothers merchandise, Camp Rock merchandise was all over Virgin and Times Square, and you'd see it on kids walking down the street. And I was like, well, what is this? Because I only heard of High School Musical. I was like, wait a minute, there's another one?
That Hannah Montana person.
Yeah, Hannah Montana or Miley Cyrus.
Yeah.
So I think Disney maybe have a knack there. Whether other producers are going to be as successful with it, who knows? I mean, I'm not sure how long Britannia High is actually going to last. If its viewing figures don't get better, I mean, obviously I don't think there'll be another season of it, because ITV just won't fund it.
No.
Not with advertising revenues dropping the way they are. It's either change their programming or they're basically just going to end up robbing Peter to pay Paul.
I do want to ask you about Beautiful People. Have you seen this show?
I've seen parts of it, and I'm not on on the YouTube.
On the YouTube, as you say.
I think it's quite funny, actually.
Yes. Now, you sent me a very clever clip, which I think I've now sent to all my friends all over the world, so it's probably done the world circuit now. Explain this clip to those who haven't seen it.
Basically, the clip is kids in a street and they're all auditioning for the same part in Joseph and his amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. And they're all showing off their different expertise by singing a different song. And I mean, it's done very well. And the piece finishes with the children who are auditioning disappearing down this yellow brick road on their way to school to the audition. And it ends up the two boys don't want the role of Joseph. The girl gets the role of Joseph, which is, you know, the big plot twist at the end of it.
Oh, okay.
But I thought it was very well done. fun.
Yeah. Do you ever watch The Simpsons or Family Guy?
I do. I watch The Simpsons as much as I can because it's on terrestrial TV, which is what I have. And my friend is a massive fan of Seth MacFarlane, and she sent me some of the songs. And today I had my iPod on shuffle, mm-hmm. and on the train this morning, one of the Family Guy songs came on, and it's incredibly crude, and it's about cartoon characters. And consequently, I've spent the whole day humming to myself this ridiculously crude song. But it's very catchy.
I think we deserve to play a clip from All Cartoons Are Fucking Pricks,
which is the song that I was singing all day.
Yeah.
On Monday I had drinks with Barney Rubble. We hit a couple divey little bars. We noticed there was quite a lovely lady sitting at the table next to ours. Now Barney, who was pretty friggin' wasted, got up and stumbled over with a groan. He said, hey, just between us, my Neanderthalic penis is as massive as a stegosaurus bone.
What's your favourite verse from that song? I like the one about Scrappy-Doo.
Oh, I love the one about Scrappy-Doo as well. It's very funny.
Yeah.
No, it's just, I like the one about Barney Rubble as well. Yeah. And Elmer Fudd.
Elmer Fudd. Obviously, Seth MacFarlane is a huge musical theatre fan.
And
he has a brilliant voice, you know, for him to do Stewie and Peter and Brian and Quagmire. In some of the songs on the album Family Guy Live in Las Vegas, he's singing, you know, himself for 10 minutes. He does a TV medley of 80s and 90s sitcom themes.
I mean, it's incredible.
Yeah.
It's incredible the way he swaps voices. I mean, it's such a talent.
And he was actually trained by Frank Sinatra's vocal coach.
I didn't know that.
So he's a huge talent to this world, along with his $100 million writing fee that he's now got from Fox. The Simpsons was first to do this. They did lots of musical parodies, you know, like the monorail. They did a musical version.
Oh, I love the monorail. I love that.
They did the Streetcar Named Desire musical, Streetcar! Exclamation mark. They did they did parodies of Be Our Guest and Under the Sea, and obviously had an influence on Seth MacFarlane, so maybe I can bring my love of musicals into this show. And recently, I've seen one of the new episodes, and they have a parody of Dadu from Little Shop of Horrors. Of course, a very famous parody of Somewhere That's Green from Little Shop of Horrors, sung by Herbert the Pervert, which has to be seen to be believed. You know, they've done The Music Man in there when they did Shapoopy, and they've done Annie when they did This House Is Freaking Sweet. Very, very tight parodies, and they nearly got sued by Disney for doing something that sounded very similar to When You Wish Upon a Star, which was their song called When You Wish Upon a Weinstein, where Peter prays for a Jewish person to come and help sort his accounts out.
A lot of the humour in parodies has always been on the line, though. Whenever you write something, put it out there, you've got to accept that, you know, parodies do happen. And I always think it's a bit of a shame when people do go after people for doing it, because if it's done well, it's actually a tribute to the original work.
Yeah, of course it is.
You know, if you don't like something, you're not going to make a parody of it, are you, for goodness sake?
No.
Seth MacFarlane's work on Family Guy, I mean, some of it is, it's so clever. And a lot of it is, you know, very much on the line and of taste and decency, but that works
it,
for Family Guy.
Sometimes the jokes are a bit, you know, you think, did they really do that and get away with it in America?
Yeah, that's the thing I love about Family Guy, actually, is you go, oh, they're not straight laces as everyone thought they were, because they just wouldn't have that on there. One of my favourite things, actually, if you can find it, is if you go on YouTube, fantastic piece of footage of Seth MacFarlane hosting kind of one of the, you know how in America they do focus groups where they ask them, you know, what their opinion of the programming schedule
yes.
is?
That's their 100th episode special. It was a whole joke of, I'm not sure if it was real, I'm not sure if it was fake. That's how tightly done this was.
Yeah, it's one of the funniest things I've ever seen in my life. And whether it was scripted or whatever, I don't know, but it was very funny.
And he sort of says, would Jesus watch Family Guy or something like that? And, you know, it's very, very, very funny. Lisa, thank you very much for your wonderful insight, as always.
You're welcome. It's nice to speak to you.
Musical Talk.
Well, that was a very interesting conversation. I have to say immediately that actually I've also watched Britannia High, and much to my surprise, very much to my surprise, I rather like it.
But you like High School Musical.
No, I don't like High School Musical. I have found a place in my heart where it doesn't hurt. at the time of recording, only two episodes have so far been broadcast. It's a high-profile ITV drama aimed at a particular demographic, as I think you pointed out. Now, the first episode was written by Jonathan Harvey. Now, Jonathan Harvey is an interesting writer in that he's done stage drama, serious stuff, quite often with music intertwined in it, and indeed some of his straight shows are named after songs. Hushabye Mountain from Chitty Chitty Bang Bang is one. And of course there's a lot of music in Beautiful Thing, which he wrote from The Mamas and the Papas. And he wrote sitcoms on television, because he wrote Gimme Gimme Gimme, also named after a musical. He's currently responsible for Beautiful People. So music runs through his veins, and of course he's written musicals, because he wrote Closer to Heaven with the Pet Shop Boys, which ran with Paul Keating a few years ago in London's West End, which I saw. Very good.
No relation to Andrew.
As far as I'm aware, no relation to Andrew. Andrew's never mentioned it. If you're listening, Andrew, do let us know, won't you? I expect a text message by return. But also, he wrote last year's Barbican Pantomime, which was Jack and the Beanstalk, with music by Styles.
Giles
and Stew. Yes, you know them. With music by Styles and Drew. So he has written musicals, he's written straight plays for theatre, and he's written television drama, and he's written television comedy. So he's very versatile. He's not responsible for all the episodes of Britannia High, but he was given the all-important first episode. And you're you're quite right in that the series is very definitely aimed at teenagers, and therefore it's not what you might call sophisticated. None of the, you know, it's the plots are not clever. However, the writing is clever, and by that I don't mean the plot structuring. I mean the fact that Jonathan Harvey has, obviously, to entertain himself and anyone over the age of 21. Popped in an awful lot of satire. There's sly comedy. It's almost poking fun of itself. So I enjoyed Britannia High. You've described it already. I mean, the very first episode is here we are, all new students at this dance school, this theatre school. Let's meet up. The songs in it by Gary Barlow are not awful songs. In fact, the opening sequence of the very first episode lasts 3.5 minutes. The opening credits are, if you like, a mini episode. The songs don't carry the plot forward in any sense, but they are reflecting the mood of the moment we get in. So everything is
quite high school music.
Yeah, everything is diegetic in the sense that, you know, let's go off and record a song, they say, and let's sing a song at the end at a party and all this kind of stuff. So, but no one ever bursts into song just because they feel like bursting into song. There's always a good reason for it, but the songs always reflect on something that's happened in the plot. So in the first episode, Lauren being bullied by the bitchy one, who looks a little bit like Posh Spice, in my view, and I'm sure has been made to look like that. But when she's singing her song is all about, I'm not going to let you get me down, you rat bag, I'm going to survive.
So they're all very upbeat, positive, yes, numbers, like High School Musical as well.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, High School Musical is a fair reflection of it, but I think its other father or mother or progenitor is fame. Now, Fame, if you like, took exactly the same concept on television, and indeed film originally. Film 1980, turned into a TV series in 1982, and was exactly the same concept. Sorry?
And then it was turned into a musical.
That's right, because it's either been in London, it's not on at the moment, is it?
But it's done many UK tours. Andy Edwards was involved in the touring production, and of course it had the yellow cab on stage, which they all jump up and dance on, and...
That sounds to me as though it's an adaptation of the film, probably. The TV series ran for six series, 136 episodes, between 1982 and 1987. And it's exactly the same plot. It's a group of new students to Fame Academy, or a theatrical school, as we might like to call it. And it's about the soap opera aspects of their lives themselves, interspersed with songs. Every episode had two or three songs in it, many of which went on to become pop hits. In this country, the two most famous are High Fidelity and Star Maker. And there were various albums.
I don't know any of those.
Yes, but if you were my generation, you wouldn't fail to do it. In fact, I had this conversation with somebody the other day, and they immediately said, oh, High Fidelity.
To me, that's a book by Nick Hornby.
Yes, but that book came out well after.
And also a musical, which failed.
Well, that's fair, but it's a single first, and you'll find it did very well, certainly in Britain.
Should we hear a clip?
Other boys may turn me off, but I let temptation slide. So plain to see the hunger in my eyes, but now I'm buying, trying.
And that was a clip of High Fidelity. The series was set, apparently, in the New York City High School for the Performing Arts. And but what's interesting, to show you whether the songs were relevant to the episodes or not, in America, it's still being syndicated on television. Each episode was originally an hour long and two or more songs in it. However, there's two versions in syndication. There's the full episode version and the version where they take out all the music and subplots, which runs to half an hour, which goes to show that the music wasn't actually necessary. You know, it's not there to develop the plot. The theme song is extremely famous. To this day, people of my generation, rising 40s, and possibly a little younger, might...
It's like the weather report.
Yes, absolutely. It's, you will find in parties, people will still say things like, well, fame costs, and here's where you start paying in sweat.
Fame song sort of was, to me, it sounds like Flashdance and it sounds like Footloose. It's all those kind of same 80s,
exactly, early
leg,
80s
leg warmers and all that.
Well, I mean, that's exactly where it comes from. But Britannia High is doing exactly the same thing for the current generation, really. I mean, it's aimed at the same demographic. It's a soap opera with some songs stuck in it, pop songs. I mean, they're contemporary. I mean, all the Fame songs were of the 80s. Britannia High, the songs are by Gary Barlow, who's really a pop writer from the 90s, but still going strong.
And
the songs, they're very good songs, actually, I think. I want to draw attention to a particular episode. It's an episode from the second series of Fame, and it's called Not in Kansas Anymore, which will give you a clue as to what happened. And the plot is, after a bump on the head, the comedy character called Doris, who, for British listeners, will understand, is the equivalent of the Sue Pollard character in Heidi High. She's the wannabe who's never going to quite do it because she's a bit lumpen and not quite talented enough. That's the way she was portrayed. She gets bonked on the nut or hit on the head and has a dream that she is in The Wizard of Oz. And therefore, for the rest of the episode, she goes through The Wizard of Oz story with her friends. So the Leroy character plays the Scarecrow. Danny plays the Lion. Tender-hearted Bruno plays the Tin Man. She's auditioning to star in the show. In real, you know, the plot opens with her auditioning to star in the show. Then she has her accident. She dreams that she's in it. Of course, she's referred to as Dottie throughout, rather than Doris or Dorothy. And she and her dance teachers and her school teachers play the good witches and the bad witches. So the dance teacher is the good witch, and the English teacher is the bad witch. Not that that was ever mentioned in The Wizard of Oz. And the episode even starts in black and white and then goes into colour when the adventure's in... And I remember various bits of it from my own childhood. I remember them. There's a long, complicated and quite unfunny sequence where there's a sign. They reach the door to the city, the Emerald City, obviously, and it says, don't knock the door. And it hilariously means don't criticise the door rather than don't actually knock on it, as we might stick our preposition. And the episode was nominated for an Emmy for the Outstanding Achievement in Music Composition for a series.
Was it pastiche music of songs from The Wizard of Oz?
No. Everything in the whole series was 80s, absolutely bang smack contemporary. But the reason I mention that is because it brings us very nicely on that plot line, being bumped on the head, having some kind of head trauma, and hearing music. It takes us very nicely to the episode of Scrubs, which is called My Musical. And we've both seen this.
Now, I like Scrubs.
Well, we both like Scrubs, that's right. I find Scrubs a very funny series. And I'm delighted that at the moment it looks like it's still going on. But when the musical episode happened in the history of Scrubs, it was in Series 6, it was thought at the time that was going to be the last series, which is why they were letting their hair down a bit. So they decided to go with the musical episode, which is something they hadn't...
But it's, I mean, Scrubs goes into song all the time. It sort of fits so well with the...
I think all the time might be pushing it, but it has in the past, yes. You're quite right. There are episodes where they also burst into song. There's a West Side Story balcony scene, a kind of Romeo and Juliet sequence between...
They did a medieval... I can't remember the titles, but they did a medieval-style episode which had, you know, sort of princess singing, where is my prince, my prince, my prince. And they, an episode I saw recently, they had a sort of mock gospel number.
Yes, you're right, there's lots of songs in it, but this is an episode that's dedicated to being a musical and falls very squarely in the discussion we're having. Of course, Scrubs is just one of a long line of TV programmes and indeed radio programmes which have done musical versions. Buffy is probably the most famous, and I'm sure we'll talk about that in a later episode of Musical Talk. Just briefly to show our roots, I'll just go back, because I've done a bit of research and discovered actually the first specifically written radio musical comedy ever was in 1924. It was broadcast on the BBC, and it was called The Dogs of Devon. The Dogs of Devon immediately and completely differently to you conjures up The Hound of the Baskervilles to me, of course.
Oh, yes.
But I can't tell you what it's about. It's called The Dogs of Devon. It was by Ernest Bullock, transmitted originally in 1924, and got 5,000 letters of praise to the BBC as a direct result of that. Now, at the time, the number of people listening to licensed radio sets in 1924, bearing in mind
200,
was very small, because radio had only been going for 2 years as a proper broadcasting service in this country, and I believe we were the first in the world. And there was a big rival outside broadcast that year. In the books of that year, radio broadcasting that year, the big event for radio was the outside broadcast, the very early outside broadcast, of George V, who was the king, opening the Empire exhibition at Wembley. That was broadcast on the wireless and didn't get nearly as much audience appreciation as this musical. So there is a long, and one may say a successful, line of musicals being specifically written for new media outside of theatre.
Medium.
I mean, we know that films took it up and ran with it, but radio we don't think of so much, television we don't think of so much, but it has come in. And Scrubs is just one of the later versions of that. Which takes us back to the episode of Scrubs, my musical, and I'm drawing that parallel with Fame, which is that JD, the central doctor, if you don't know, and his female central doctor friend, Elliot, are in a park when a woman collapses. And when the woman wakes up again, she hears songs, and therefore for the rest of the episode, whenever she's in a scene, characters appear to be singing to each other. That's the conceit. So it's clearly they aren't actually singing, and that's made very plain. So it still fits in the continuity of the series, but in her head she has it. Now, it's interesting, the writer of the story, who's Deborah Faldham, who's one of the staff writers on the Scrubs team, who'd been sort of commissioned to do this musical, did some research with the medical research people involved in the programme.
Don't say this disease exists.
It's a genuinely classified case. It is. She researched a case study on musical hallucinations associated with seizures originating from an intracranial aneurysm.
How dare you.
Yes, but that's so, ladies and gentlemen, fact got there before fiction did.
That's incredible.
I think it's quite unusual, but, you know, in medical...
I bet there'll be pop rhymes as well.
Well, let's talk about the music. I mean, the music in it, bearing in mind it's a half-hour episode.
Listeners of Musical Talk should go back and listen to the Jeff Marks interview.
Because Jeff Marks was incidentally involved in writing...
some of the songs.
Yeah, exactly. And indeed, it so happens that the woman who hears the songs...
Stephanie Dabruzzo.
Dabruzzo, isn't
Dabruzzo.
She? Is also an alumni from the original Broadway cast of Avenue Q.
Dabruzzo on my head hurts quite hard.
Ho, ho. It starts with a song called All Right, I'm going to be honest, I love Scrubs, but I thought this episode was a bit underwhelming. It got better as it went on, but really it didn't, because I don't think it hit the ground running. It took me a while to start to enjoy it. I did enjoy it by the end, but I don't think it's by any means the best episode of Scrubs.
I enjoyed it when the big opening beyond All Right, when the classic opening number comes.
Welcome to Sacred Heart.
Everyone.
Hello, I'm Dr. Kelso. I'm delighted that you came. So the doctors say you fainted and you don't know what's to blame. Well, put your mind at ease. There's no ill we can't outsmart. On behalf of all who work here,
welcome to Sacred Heart.
Are excellent. You couldn't ask for more.
As long as you avoid the bathrooms on the second floor.
So why didn't they open with that? That's the problem for me. Yeah, it starts off with good kind of Busby Barclay. Well, I say starts off. You have this prelude, which is the All
very
Right.
Very much in the Scrubs musical style.
Oh, you mean following its own...
Very percussive, lots of guitars and drums and that. But then it goes into, okay, we're in a different world here. And I think maybe they did that to introduce the Scrubs music, and then it goes into a musical theatre music, if that makes any sense. Nope. Okay.
You're talking about Welcome to Sacred Heart, which is the big Busby Barclay number, which had 50 extra dancers roped in just to make it and there were sort of crane shots, aerial shots, giving you that kind of Esther Williams look as well.
And the Los Angeles Symphony Orchestra.
Were they involved? Oh, I didn't know that. And it has to be, in a way, it's Dr. Kelso, who's sort of the hospital managing director, welcoming her, the victim, if you like, who's called Patty, I think, to the hospital. And, of course, he has actually been in musicals on Broadway anyway.
Patty?
He's a Broadway musical star. It's described online, actually, if you look. He's described as being like Robert Preston from The Music Man, which, of course, is quoted also in Monorail in the episode of The Simpsons. Yes. That kind of... I'm not, in that case, a charlatan, but, you know, someone who comes in and gets everybody involved. So that's the kind of thing there. The song's also influenced by Be Our Guest from Beauty and the Beast. Anyway, you then go into another song which I thought didn't work, and that's called Everything Comes Down to Poo, which is all about the fact that medical profession relies very firmly on stool samples.
Everything comes down to poo. From the top of your head to the sole of your shoe, we can figure out what's wrong with you by looking at your poo. Turk.
Now, the problem is, I think it was supposed to be quirky and fun, but I think it mispitched what it was going to do. Apparently, the lyrics were rewritten and rewritten and rewritten, because every time they came in, they were either too...
crude.
Yeah, they were either too crude and vulgar, or they weren't crude and vulgar enough. And indeed, you can find...
a hard line to balance, I think.
Well, and I don't think they got it right. I think they might as well have just been done with the song and got rid of it. Some of the lyrics have been changed, and that's already on public record. One of them was, "It may sound gross, it may sound crass, but we need to see what comes out of your..."
Yes, thank you.
The American pronunciation, rather than arse. That was changed as being too... that was identified as being too crude, and it came up with a rather twee-sounding... "It may sound gross, you may say shush, but we need to see what comes out of your tush." Yes, quite.
If you have a song about poo, I mean, you might...
Well, I think you've just said the word that makes the problem for it. Nobody but nobody but nobody uses the word poo unless you're under six. Then there's a song called "Gonna Miss You, Carla," which is a perfectly standard missing you already song, because she's thinking of going on maternity leave. And then we get the song that really started to make me more interested, which is the Gilbert and Sullivan pastiche, the song called "The Rant Song," sung unsurprisingly by Dr. Perry Cox.
He's a brilliant, brilliant character.
Yes.
And an actor, brilliant.
But he can't dance. So they found a song for him, an ideal kind of song, where you don't have to dance, where he could match to his kind of singing skills, which also matched his character. And that's the point. The songs all match the character.
He can't sing either.
He speaks song, sings, but yeah. He can sing after a fashion. But he does the... It's very much a kind of "I am the very model of a modern major general" from The Pirates of Penzance, which has been quoted and used and ripped off a million times. Even on television, there's a programme called Studio 60 on the Sunset Strip, did exactly the same thing. Pinky and the Brain, which is a cartoon series, did it. The Wild Thornberrys did it. And most famously, probably, Animaniacs did it. And that's just four examples. It's been done a million times in a million places.
"It's your hair, your nose, your chinless face. You always need a hug, not to mention all the manly apple teenies that you chug. That you think I am your mentor just continues to perplex. And oh my God, stop telling me when you have nerdy sex.
Oh, by the way, last time Kim was in town, we got some apple teenies and poured them on our good parts.
See now, newbie, that's the thing you do that drives me up a tree. Cause no matter how I rant at you, you never let me be. So I'm stuck with all your daydreaming, your wish to be my son. It makes me suicidal, and I'm not the only one. No, I'm not the only one."
But I think that's a very good song. And that's when I suddenly realised what they were trying to do. I realised that the songs were different parodies, different spoofs. A lot of Gilbert and Sullivan spoofs don't work, but that one did.
And the janitor makes an appearance, doesn't he?
That's right. Well, he sings the chorus line, if you like, almost. So, you know, you've got Dr. Cox singing the main lyric. Because in a modern major general, you've got the people in the background, the chorus, singing the background lyrics, and that's the role that the janitor plays in that. There's a song called "Options," which is about difficult conversations. Both Elliot and Carla are worrying about the difficult conversations they've got to have with JD and Turk. I think in the first case, JD's going to be... Elliot wants to move house, and she doesn't want JD, who's currently living with her, to move in with her.
That's their sort of Act 1 finale.
No, no, the Act 1 finale is called "When the Truth Comes Out."
Oh, true.
And that deliberately designed to be "Do you hear the people sing from Les Miserables?" It's got clips of everything, it all comes together, all the plot lines weave together. You can see its antecedents, that's very fair.
Even the the end.
And American television, or commercial television, works very nicely for spoofing musical theatre, in the sense that you get, well, in a half-hour programme, I assume you get one commercial break. You do in Britain. Which allows you to do an act...
three, actually.
Oh, well, that's awful, then. How can you possibly watch television if it's broken off every 10 minutes?
You get one after the opening credits. That's why American TV shows have a prelude, a bit of a scene, then the credits, then commercials, then the actual bulk of the TV show. Then there'll be a break in the middle of that. Then there's the extra add-on. Then there's a break. Then there's the credits.
Well, if I may say, how awful. How on earth do they stand it? Thank goodness for the BBC. In British television, then, it works better because at the moment, a half-hour programme will only have one set of advertisements in, and that's only on ITV. So Act 2, if you like, the second half, starts with "Guy Love," which is Turk and JD, which is a curious song. It is about...
That was the weakest one for me, I thought.
Why is that?
I didn't like the musical style. I thought it was a bit crass, you know, Guy Love, but not in a...
Gay way
or whatever.
But that's exactly what their characters are. I mean, Scrubs is curious. I mean, let's just briefly talk about the philosophy of the characters in Scrubs. It's very clear to me that JD is a gay man who just happens to be in a heterosexual body. Okay. All his characteristics are gay, except the fact he sleeps with women and loves women. And that, I think, is the unspoken secret of Scrubs. This song makes a huge amount of sense because they do really have a fraternal relationship. And it's supposed to be very much in the style of Jekyll and Hyde, apparently.
"I'll be there to care through all the lows.
I'll be there to share the highs. It's guy love between two guys. And when I say I love you, Turk, it's not what it implies. It's guy love between two guys.
Bill Lawrence, who produces the series, wanted that kind of Jekyll and Hyde, what he described as an overwrought emotional song.
I wouldn't say it was Jekyll and Hyde at all. It's an 80s pop ballad.
Well, fair enough, but that was the concept they were trying to go for. I think it's very instructive to see how it's gone down by looking at YouTube, where you can see all these clips, and then seeing the comments that people have put.
Comments, yeah, that's one way of putting some of the tripe people writing.
Yes, but... And what's interesting is the music of Guy Love turns up in two later episodes. Once as a ringtone in a later episode on Turk's telephone.
Right.
Although, interestingly, the phone call is from Carla rather than from JD. And it turns up again in incidental music in the background in an episode called My Words of Wisdom. So there's lots of in-jokes going on there. Then we get, I think, a very funny song, which is For the Last Time I'm Dominican, which is an argument between Carla and her husband Turk, who's called a Puerto Rican.
What do you think of the rhyming in that song?
Oh, well, I think you're supposed to get caught up in the comedy anger. It's like... Well, you can't help but think of West Side Story, not for quality, but for Puerto... Anyone mentions Puerto Rico in a musical, you're going to think of West Side Story. But I quite like the fact that they have this
in the Heights.
Highly choreographed tango. Argument scene, essentially. Yeah. Recorded well after the main filming, because Judy Reyes, who plays... I was going to call her Nurse Spinoza, but Carla Turk, as she now is... She'd broken her leg in the original recording. So in the original sequences, she's always sitting down. But because she had to do some dancing, she came along and did this, and it was filmed a lot later. There's a song called Friends Forever, which is when JD and Elliot sort of chum up again after their breakdown.
We Go Together from Greece.
That's exactly what it is, yeah. It's a 1950s kind of feel. Although apparently, Deborah Fordham said that when she wrote it, because she wrote the lyrics, she wasn't expecting that kind of spoof to come up. It wasn't written that way. It was orchestrated and performed that way. So it's interesting, actually, how that song has developed from the original intentions to what it became. And then there's an homage to Life Support from Rent, which is what's going to happen, which is when Patty, the poor woman who's got the brain aneurysm, is told that she could die on the operating table. But, you know, she doesn't. Hurrah! But, of course, the JD plot at the end, you know, where he does his homily, his slightly twee moment of wisdom and thought, and what have we learnt this week, chums?
Springer's final thought.
If you like, is basically that, you know, you have to make tough decisions and you could lose something in the process. So, obviously, she's going to live, but she won't now hear music, and it's all a bit sad. It's quite a fun episode, but I think it takes its while to get to... I would have rewritten the first 10 minutes myself, but it's certainly a success, I think. I think it had to be judged a success. It's the most downloaded episode from that series, apparently. Bill Lawrence has always been on record as being a huge fan of musical theatre and had always wanted to do it, but couldn't find a way of doing it that didn't feel it was forced. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until this... But because they thought the series was going to end, they thought they could risk it. And then they found a case keeping it in continuity, which is splendid.
They found a cure.
Ken Jenkins, who is Dr. Kelso, had been in a musical called Big River on Broadway.
Mark Twain story, isn't it?
I think it probably is. It sounds like it must be a Huckleberry Finn kind of thing. And most of the other cast have done some kind of musical experience in their time.
Zach Braff is also a huge musical theatre fan.
Yes, it was different, and you can find most of these facts on the internet here, there and everywhere, but unusually, because the American writing system is someone has an idea, they go off and write it, and then everyone brings it back and adds bits and pieces to it. Can't do that so easily with a musical. So it's one of those rare episodes of Scrubs which actually a person was commissioned to write it and then went off and wrote it. They were collaborators, of course, as you say, Jeff Marks, who really appreciated the opportunity. He'd always been very wary of Hollywood and coming to write for Hollywood, but apparently on the strength of the success and the good feeling that he got from Bill Lawrence's team, he moved to Los Angeles. Yes, that's exactly right. He was responsible for the music, as you say, but the genre, for the most part, was actually picked by the author, which is Deborah Fordham.
He didn't write all of the
songs.
Oh, no.
Well, go on. What do you know?
Scrubs musical composer also wrote some of the songs. And in a way, I think that's a bit of a flaw, really.
You mean lack of integration in that sense?
Yeah, because one thing I didn't get from this...
Is it Jan Stevens is the original music writer for Scrubs, I think.
Yeah.
But... Just the official listings of the people involved in the music are Jeff Marks, Robert Lopez, Deb Fordham, Paul Perry, Doug Besterman, as well as Jan Stevens.
Doug Besterman was a great... He's a great orchestrator, and he orchestrated the opening number. The thing that I was waiting for was, OK, you may have got it in the Act One finale.
When the truth comes out.
You get a sort of reprises of songs, and I would have liked to have had, you know, like a musical, you have a incidental music quoting the main themes, and you get, at the very end, you may have noticed she hums, which is Welcome to Sacred Heart, and that was nice. But I wish you had a lot more of that, and I think, you know, if you have six people writing the music and 28 producers and, you know, all these writers, it's a lot of clashing together.
Yes, but the fact they got it done at all, I mean, it must have been a very expensive episode due to the number of cast, the extra people you need to bring in, and apparently they all had a week's rehearsal as well, presumably for dancing and singing, which you don't get on American television programmes at all. Mm-hmm. Do you mark it up as a success?
Well, I love Scrubs anyway. I'm not a huge... I don't have the DVDs and I don't watch every episode in order with each other, but I will watch it if it's on or record it.
Conversely, I do have all the DVDs and I do watch it in order, but I also feel able to criticise when there's a bad episode. Mm. I don't think it's a bad episode at all. I think it's a good episode. I just wish it were yet better.
I was just thrilled to have a musical episode. Anything that uses the genre and the form is very exciting to me. Everyone worked hard, everyone sung their notes, everyone made the effort, and it was funny. So I think, and it told a generally heartwarming story.
Just all to say that it was broadcast in 2007, so it's a relatively recent addition to the world of television musicals. I think we probably just need to briefly mention the Monkees here, which is a TV series from 1966 to 68, I think, which once again was a half-hour sitcom with songs in it. Now, the songs weren't integrated in any sense. They were just pop songs. Mostly, I mean, the Monkees were created as a pop group to sell songs which weren't written by them.
It's very similar to a show when I was younger. S Club 7 had a...
That was the model... they were taking the model of the Monkees. That's exactly it. But the Monkees were the first. And it was a TV series that had songs in it. And I had a specially written... there was a composer who wrote songs especially for it. Now, they weren't integrated into the plot by any means. It was usually background music. They would either sing a song because they were required to in the plot, or the music was played over while they were being chased or something like that. It was a very popular series, the Monkees. And the Monkees, as a group, then sort of took their own creative control over time and carried on releasing albums until 1971, even though the TV series had finished before that and then had various revivals.
Did all the Monkees hits from the 60s, like Daydream Believer and The Monkees, come from that TV show?
Yeah, they were written for the Monkees, and the TV show was there to showcase that. So I don't think you can argue that the Monkees is a proper music... I mean, it's a show with music, but I don't think you can show it... You can't call those episodes musicals. In the same way, about 10 years or so later, you've got The Muppet Show. Now, The Muppet Show, once again, has music in it diegetically because they're in a musical theatre trying to put a show on. So there you've got the music coming up as part of what they're doing rather than because anyone spontaneously bursts into song through emotional power. And none of the songs push forward the plot, which is usually Miss Piggy chasing Kermit. So the songs are incidental. But it's another musical TV show. It's a show with heavy music involvement. In Britain recently, in 2004, one of our sitcoms decided it was going to follow the Buffy route and become a musical as well for one episode only, which
was... Down the Yellow Brick Road. What? Two pints of lager and a packet of crisps.
That's exactly right. But the episode's called When Janet Met Johnny. Now, Janet's played by Sheridan Smith, who was famously Audrey in the recent Little Shop of Horrors at the Menier and then transferred into London. And she's a great musical actress in her own right. But she's also in this sitcom. And Johnny is played by Ralph Little. And the whole episode is a prequel almost. She's leaving Johnny at the beginning of the episode. And then the moment she walks into the street, she then reminisces about how they met. And the whole episode, therefore, is detachable from the continuity of the series and yet also includable, if you wish it to be. You could argue that it's a proper musical.
You could, yes.
Yes. I mean, I'm going to be honest. I didn't think it was tremendously good.
No, I didn't.
I don't much like it. But the... For this episode, this one episode from 2004, February 2004, the show writer, a single person again, Susan Nixon, and she wrote the lyrics, and the music was written by somebody called Simon Brint.
Never heard of him.
There goes the interview with him there. And the series essentially is about two oddly matched couples, so breaking up wasn't that much out of the plot. What's interesting is between the songs, which are all performed as pop videos rather than... And even down to the change in the sort of film quality, it moves from sort of standard... television video to sort of outside broadcast video, which looks a bit like film, so it changes. But the musical numbers only commentate on what you've just seen or are completely relevant. I mean, the best known and funniest song in it is actually The Biscuit Rap, bizarrely, because Johnny has this bizarre obsession about Jammy Dodgers in particular, which are...
I think I remember that. I haven't seen it in a long time.
Yes.
This is what I'm seeing here. A lot of these newer ones don't do plot songs.
Well, they're not writing musicals. It's not a musical. The problem with... I mean, this may be the point we need to make. The problem with television musicals is that they aren't actually being written as musicals. They're not integrating. Scrubs is actually an attempt to do so. Not hugely successful, but an attempt to do so. But it isn't marrying it up with a plot in any real way. What they're doing is just saying, can we intersperse this? And it's interesting to me that actually, although the Buffy is a drama, most of the subsequent shows that have done musical spoofs or just musical episodes are comedies. I mean, we know about the animated...
Well, Buffy is everything, really, which is why it was such an amazing TV show.
But it's not... It's still sold as drama. It's not sold as... I've seen it. It's not a comedy. It's got comic moments. It's not a comedy. But it's still essentially a drama, and that is formally how it's classified. Mm. But all the others are not. You couldn't argue that Simpsons is drama. Simpsons is clearly comedy. Family Guy is comedy. Scrubs is a comedy. Two Pints of Lager is a comedy, after a fashion. And I think that's because...
What kind of lagers?
Because they're not trying to tell a story. No. Or if they are, they're doing it in a really cheap and... You know, it's a bolt-on. It's a gimmick. It's a gimmick rather than a genuine... attempt to write a musical piece, I think.
Do you think that's because musical theatre is seen as such a silly way of telling a story? I mean,
no.
By the general public, they sort of see it as a sort of... Oh, I don't like musicals because they break into song all the time. That's really... I don't see that happening in a drama.
I think...
If they did a musical episode of Coronation Street or something with a bit of heart, it would come across as very...
Yes, I think people would react to that badly. But yes, maybe you're right, actually. But I was actually going to say, but I think the reason these programmes do it is actually purely because Buffy's ratings went up for that one. People wanted a gimmick. And I think we're talking gimmick rather than love here. But getting back to Two Pints, I just briefly want to say that the songs were very clearly based on other songs. So there's a song which even I recognise from the 1990s, which is called Tub Thumping. Yes. You know, I fall down, I get up again, which of course is actually quoted in Scrubs, incidentally. I think it's one of the Brendan Fraser episodes where he promises to... His brain will sing it to him over and over again unless he does something that it wants. It's a bit Simpsonian, that one. But that song is very, very reminiscent in We Need Some Slags, which is sung by the two fellas. Yeah, we're working at that level of comedy. But there are parodies of Marilyn Manson, Christine Arugalera, whose name I can't say.
Aguilera, dear.
Thank you very much. Pulp. And even Steps and S Club 7, that kind of, you know, or dance-based music. So they've taken, bearing in mind it was written in 2004, but is retrospective and therefore in the 90s, they've taken the hits of the 90s. So it's contemporary with the period it's trying to be in, mm-hmm. but it wears its homage, shall we say politely, very, very broadly. I mean, as I say, I don't listen to pop music, but if I was able to recognise the hits of the 1990s creeping through the holes in the songs, it was watchable, but only for about half an hour, I think.
Which
is
the length of the show.
But it didn't make me watch any of the other shows, let's put it that way. I didn't become a fan of Two Pints from that. Mm. And that's really my adventures in television musicals. I would like to see somebody write a proper musical for television. It has happened, of course. I'm just thinking about both Cole Porter and Rodgers and Hammerstein. Cinderella. This is off the top of my head. I've suddenly remembered that Cinderella was written as a television musical. This is in the 50s when television was still big and lovely.
ABC.
Was it ABC? All right, okay. Starring a very young Mary Poppins.
Do you mean Julie Andrews?
I do mean Julie Andrews. Thank you very much indeed. And also, some genuine standards came out of it. Do I love you because you're beautiful or are you beautiful because I love you?
Well,
it's thank you, Nick. you can answer that. But it's a genuinely great standard. It's been covered by everybody.
And then, of course, Disney remade it.
That's right. But with the same score, wasn't it? That's right. Because the original telecast was lost, the recording. But they found it again since. So you can actually...
It's behind the sofa.
You can watch both. And also... I believe that Cole Porter, on the strength of the success of Cinderella, also did a musical for television only, which I can't remember the name of. I have a feeling it might be By Jupiter, but I might have to double-check that.
But if you're talking about, you know, musicals made for TV, there's been loads of them. Disney did one called Geppetto.
Yeah, but forgive me, those are all sequels. When you say made for TV, you're talking about for their channel and sequels to films they've made. They haven't written, I suppose you could argue High School Musical was, but it's, that's interesting.
But Geppetto had a brilliant score by Stephen Schwartz.
Oh, I'm sure it did, but it's a sequel to Pinocchio.
It's the prequel to Pinocchio.
All right, it's just, fine, but it's it wouldn't have existed if Pinocchio didn't.
No, true.
And Pinocchio is, what, 1939, 1941? That's a long time ago. And yes, they've done millions and millions of straight-to-DVD and video sequels. And indeed, Disney is, as I think I've said before, the film company that has specifically made kept film musicals alive from the moment it started. Although they're made for TV, they're all TV movies, they're all films. The medium of television, I don't think, has been exploited for musical theatre, except in the 50s when a couple of the Rodgers and Hammersteins and people like that had a go. But I can't think of any famous composer who's written a specific television musical, if we make the difference between that and film was made by the Disney Corporation. And what other television companies doing it?
I know they did an episode. I mean, we obviously need to come back and revisit this subject later.
Clearly, yeah.
Because there's so, I mean, Animaniacs and all the sort of modern American cartoons. Xena, Warrior Princess had a musical episode.
Really?
There's a very famous and funny Australian, I think it's New Zealand, show called Flying Concords, which uses songs. Quite, you know, that's something we're going to revisit. I know Dom is a big fan of that show. There's obviously so many other shows, and it is a trend, I think, that hopefully will continue into the future.
Oh, well, that's interesting. I don't think it's a trend I admire. I no, because I think they're sham musicals. I don't think they're good enough.
Well, I think a TV show should make a good...
Oh, right, but right, we'll wait for that to happen rather than for it to continue. Yeah, there we are.
Thos is joined next week by wonderful Gillian Fellowes of Mary Poppins and Gosford Park, which I rewatched the other day.
It's a great film, isn't
Brilliant
it?
Brilliant
film. Yes. And we'll be talking about Gillian Fellowes' career, both in musical theatre and screenwriting. Also, we'll be talking about Ivan Novello, of course, who appears in Gosford Park. And
not the real Ivan Novello.
We will be talking... Well, we're talking about the real Ivan Novello because it seems an appropriate time to do so, as we'll be talking to Gillian Fellowes about him. And so I'm also joined in the studio by Dr. Michael Williams, who is one of the world's experts on Ivan Novello.
So we'll see you next week. Thank you very much, Thos.
Bye-bye. Thank you, Nick.
Ta-ta.
This has been a production of Musical Talk, copyright 2008. If you have any questions or comments, please email us at feedback@musicaltalk.co.uk. Thanks for listening.
Musical Out Talks.
Go to the Rocky Horror website for the German tour. Okay. It's the most complicated and unnecessary. I mean, it looks fantastic, but it's far too complicated for its own good.
The
website has put in every possible kind of... do you want to do your sound check? Sorry.
I just want to get this up, so to speak.
I'm glad we're recording this. Is it up yet? You're using both hands to get it up, I see.
Just twisting it really hard.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Ow. Can you do it?
Do you want me to hold the bottom?
What are you trying to do?
Just twist it so it goes up.
Is it one of those... Don't you have to lift it up, or is it... Is it just a restraining bolt, which then you have to lift up? Yeah, like that. Okay. Is that the kind of thing you're after, or do you want it higher than that? You want it higher than that, don't you? Yeah. That's as high as it goes, darling.
Thank you. Anything else want to fall over and...
This is small fry compared to what I've had. Well, if I'm looking at you, and I'll probably be doing what I normally do, which is sort of looking at notes and things like that, so I'll be speaking in this tone. How's that look?
That's fine. I will do intros and outros. We can do intros and outros.
You'll do a studio link. Go on, you do your one again.
One again. So I can change all this.
Yeah, I was going to say it looks about right, doesn't it? Okie dokie. If you're going to do a studio link, are we going to go straight in? Do you want to launch, or shall I? Or just start the conversation and then cut in when you think it's appropriate?
You can do it, yeah.
Well, of course, I understand, Nick.
We're doing a whole opening beginning.
Oh, are we?
Welcome to episode.
Oh, in which case, as you're the anchor man on this, you should launch and then...
Just wait for the clock to finish. Yeah.
You need to be careful of your volumes, clearly.
So I've worked out how to...
Compress it all.
Yeah.
Oh, that's your fit at.
Sorry?
As you say in our outtakes with Tim, which I've got so many messages about our High School Musical porn outtakes.
Yes. They seem to go down surprisingly well, I thought, but except from the Disney Corporation's point of view, I should think.
I was just listening to this on the bus and, you know, everyone wondered why I burst out laughing and bonked the top. I was looking through a Toys R Us catalogue and the High School Musical crap they have on sale.
Well, it's because 3's just come out, isn't it? I'm going to force myself to watch High School Musical 2 over Christmas, probably. just to keep up with it.
Then three.
One feels one has to. Well, I will do three, but I should give it a
That's
while.
That's next year.
Yeah, it probably will be, actually. I mean, I did High School Musical 1 last Christmas. So. Right, do your intro, young man.
Well, Thos, what did you think of that interview?
It went very much quicker than I expected.
Yes.
Loads of our local schools up here are actually high schools.
Yeah, the common schools are.
The common schools. No, just well, they're defined common.
Not paid but, for.
Yeah, no, not all.
It's a show I haven't seen yet, but the clip you gave me certainly did open my eyes to that show, and I will try and look out for further episodes.
Guy Fawkes Night.
I know, you can hear it, can't you? It's
Yeah.
Oh, for fuck's sake, can you stop it? Thank you.
They've been going off here all night.
Yes, it's rather annoying. You'll forgive the blitz. Forgive the blitz going on in the background. It'll be over in a couple of years. for someone who said, "I will have nothing to contribute," this 30-minute conversation has surely flown by.
Oh, it's not getting me to talk that's a problem. It's shutting me up.
I know. Well, shut up. Thank you very much.
Okay, then. I'll speak to you soon.
Bye.
Bye.
Well, that was a very interesting conversation. Now, just for devil's
It's easy for you to say.
Yeah, apparently.
That was a good discussion.
Sorry, I'm trying to find if I've got the details, because you're quite right. It did...
Right. Okay.
Yeah. You filling in, right. Okay, I can't find the details for that.
What details were you looking for?
I was trying to look for the other episodes, because it's... But taking us back to that Fame episode, what happens is, as I'm sure you know, JD and Elliot...
Scrubs.
Yes, this isn't... What did I say?
Fame.
Damn.
Which I'm going to shut the window because...
Yeah, it's raining. Quite heavily. Okie dokie.
I had a theory that the janitor isn't actually there and he's only there within JD's mind.
That was a theory in the first two series because he only ever interacted with JD. But of course, he by the end of the series, he's interacting with... Well, in later series, he's interacting with all the characters. So that theory has now been debunked. Scrubs fans.
Scrubbed away.
If you like. Squeaky chair you have there, grandmother.
Yeah. All the better to...
I don't know. I mean, do you mark it up as a success? Do you
yes,
mark
I
it
do.
Up?
Yes, I do mark it up as a...
I'll start that again. And I don't think the series is tremendously good. I think it relies on crudity over wit anyway.
My father loves it.
Does he really?
Yes.
Well, good luck to him.